Let's Talk is a series of interviews with remarkable Australians.
Yep.
Simply, it's been designed to normalise difficult conversations and aimed at helping the day-to-day challenges that many of us face.
Okay.
Dani Laidley has lived on this planet for more than half a century.
Beautiful old building.
For so much of her life, she wasn't who she wanted to be.
The great one.
Hey.
But has only now found peace and calm. So, Let's Talk. Presented by AIA.
Dani, thank you for doing this.
Thank you for having me.
So, I'm learning. When I make a mistake, point it out because I need to learn and whoever's watching needs to too.
Yep.
The definition of gender dysphoria, the distress a person experiences due to a mismatch between their gender identity and the sex assigned at birth. When did gender dysphoria enter your world?
Probably as a 5 or 6 year old was the first time I can remember feeling a little different.
Mm-hmm.
Through some experiences that my mum had at Avon party, you know, all those years ago. And then there was lots of other instances growing up where I just didn't know what this thing was. Sometimes it would be very quiet. Other times it was like you're at a rock concert. You know, that voice, it's just it's there all the time.
What was it saying?
Just, you know, I just always felt like I wasn't in the world.
Really?
You know, I was sort of walking around like a little bit in my own bubble, perhaps. And, you know, it was me probably having the feelings of why do I feel like this? Why do I feel like this on the inside and look so different on the outside?
For you, they weren't in harmony.
No, but it is now what I know, and I've been able to label it, if you like, as little Danielle. And as I said, some days she'd be roaring and want recognition and...
attention?
Yeah. And then other days it was very, very quiet, you know, and very still, so to speak. But then the roaring of the storm would happen. That probably, the real roar, the roaring and the loud probably didn't come until, you know, later in my teens. And then as I've got older, it just became unmanageable. I couldn't operate on a daily basis. You know, and even through my coaching period where senior coach of an AFL club, family, you know, you've got all these other parts of your life, it took its toll. It really did.
So was it an everyday conversation you were having with yourself?
Pretty much. There were days where I could operate with my eyes out, and there was which were much easier days because you could connect with people, but there were other days where it was eyes in all day, you know, and the questions and the toing and froing and, you know, what is this thing? Why do I feel the way I do? Why do I, you know, look into the mirror and not be happy with what you see? And, you know, that manifested its way through 8, 9, 10, 11, you know, 12 years of age, until, you know, I was probably in my early teens, and I'd come home after school, and no mobile phones in those days, but home phones, and, you know, all my friends would say, you know, do you want to come out and do something, and I'd say, oh no, I got too much homework. So I would stay home and get an opportunity, 12, 13, 14, to be myself, where I could look into the mirror and be happy with what I saw. Still not understanding what is this, but having fear of hearing the car pull up, or mum walking through the door and absolutely tearing shreds off me about, you know, what I was doing.
So you had makeup on, or you were dressing as you wanted to dress?
Yep. And more experimenting at that time. But whenever I got to that point, it was peaceful. No noise. I felt like I was home. And the best way I can describe gender dysphoria is, if anyone's ever been homesick, you've been away from home where you feel safe, you feel warm, you miss the smell of your pillow, you know, all those little things. And when I was at that place, that's how I felt.
Most comfortable.
Most comfortable. You know, that's how I felt. And it progressively got much, much worse as I got older.
That was 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 years of age. That's a long time ago. 41 years of living a life, I guess, which is essentially a lie, must be exhausting.
It took its toll. You know, from a young age, going down to West Perth, and even that was quite surreal how I actually got there. Because through those years we were just talking about, I actually got really sick. I got a really bad dose of glandular fever and stopped playing footy and cricket. And year 10 was rolling around, where it was the state under 15s schoolboys. And one of the teachers was a selector at our school. And look, I eventually, they dragged me down to try out for the state schoolboys. 6 weeks later, I'm in the best 25 kids in the state. And thought, oh, okay, what do I do here? And then footy really quickly, I went from state schoolboys to playing league footy at West Perth before West Coast Eagles came in. Great Dennis Cometti was my first coach.
Great man,
Dennis. And very quickly, what it did was just, it's very hard to describe sometimes, but it would just balance this little Danielle, if you like, with my football. It seemed to keep me reasonably balanced.
Being busy being Dean kept little Danielle at bay for a while.
Yep.
And the busier you were here,
yes,
the less roaring.
So, because I didn't know what this was, I just kept putting my head and being busy and busy and busy. And that went right through my playing and my coaching career. And, you know, the discipline of being in the AFL kept you on track. And I did have a love-hate affair with football. I knew I was reasonable at it, but at times I would think that, well, what am I going to do, little Danielle, over here? Where is this going to go to?
You knew at some point,
yeah,
little Danielle needed to be addressed.
Yep.
Yeah, and you were kicking her down the road.
Yeah, and, you know, I learned probably only in the last 5 or 6 years that you can't outrun gender dysphoria. You can do so many things. And one of them was to decide whether to be here or not.
That's effectively choose to leave the world or choose to live in the world in whatever shape that is.
Yeah, I mean, there were so many times that for a lot of years I'd actually fleetingly thought about it.
Yeah.
But it wasn't much more than that. But that really came on strong from probably 2012, 13, 14. And I thought it was, I was at the front of the queue and it was my time to fly off and it'd be much easier for everyone if I wasn't here. I just didn't decide to be who I am today. It's been there for as long as I can remember. I didn't manage it very well, and it had a large effect on me as a person. If you asked around the AFL, you know, over such a long period of time, it would be, smart, football brain, can go really well, but also can be volcanic and angry. And they were the two behaviours that manifested out of what was going on over here that no one knew about.
Right.
So the choice was to live rather than wander off into the sunset. And the first reason is to be myself and be here for my children. You know, they've been my world. Perhaps it may have been easier in some way, shape or form to take the other option, because this option in its ways is been much harder, but it's also been so rewarding, and I wouldn't change it for the world now. So I'm just so grateful that through those self-harming episodes that I was no good at it, and I'm still here.
When you were coaching, you would at the end of the season disappear for a month, go to Vegas and be you.
Yep.
You were doing that because you obviously needed to.
Mm-hmm.
Were you terrified that you would get caught?
Not as terrified as going out in Melbourne or Sydney.
Which you were doing?
Yes. But still terrified. And the good thing about being in the States or Vegas is very easy to hear an Aussie accent amongst all the American accents.
Yeah.
So, but your radar's always up. Going to Vegas or going to Sydney through those periods of time, it wasn't me. It was still a mask. It was very draggy. But it was a way of going out and expressing and being myself and getting back to that place, that home, if you like. You know, I was doing it for the inside. If that makes sense.
When were you finally diagnosed and what was the relief like at that point?
So I got the diagnosis in late November, early December 2019, after a period of time of seeing Dr. Ada Chung. And the day that she told me, I remember walking out of the clinic and skipping for about a K and a half back to my car. It had felt like this huge weight had been lifted off my shoulders. It felt like I'm no longer this crazy person who was always, you know, eyes in, doing head miles. It was like we'd unlocked the key and I could now slowly start to move forward. What that looked like, I was unsure of, even though I'd already been self-medicating on the HRT before I went and saw Ada, which is probably the wrong thing to do again.
Was that because you self-medicated because you didn't want to have the conversation with someone, make it official, you were too ashamed, too embarrassed?
Correct.
Wow.
Yes. So I was buying estrogen patches, testosterone blockers, and it was costing me like $500 a month. And they were the same products as what I use now. What I find really interesting through that period of time that I was self-medicating and using the testosterone blockers, when they first tested me, my testosterone levels were already in the female range.
Is that right? Yep. Didn't know that.
Yeah, which is quite staggering considering I played AFL footy for all those years and, you know, high performance training and, you know, you would think that would...
Yeah.
But, yeah, that was that.
So when Ada said you have gender dysphoria and you skipped back to your car...
Yep.
What were you thinking was the way forward from there? Because you were still a hugely recognised face.
So I made one phone call to my ex-wife, who'd already knew.
Assumed or knew?
Knew about me.
Okay.
Yeah, and had done for a number of years.
Yes.
And she said, well, we need to sit down and tell the kids and we'll work our way through it. So this is just before Christmas. So Christmas bowls along and we sort of never get around to it. And,
was it a conversation you were dreading?
Yeah.
You'd been keeping things quiet for the bulk of your life. Mm. It gets to a point where it's no more.
No. Because I couldn't live. It was a train wreck. You know, around those years of 17, 18, 19, I was living as myself in all facets of my life except for my 9-to-5 job in front of my children. So it got to the point where I was ready for that. Unfortunately, a few things happened and we never got to have that conversation before it became public.
And allegedly, through the police releasing private photos and having what was a very private secret matter not just become known by your family or friends or Victorians or Australians, but the world.
The world.
Like that.
Like that. There's a firestorm.
Next time on Let's Talk.
I didn't know what to do. I was even more scared to reach out. And I probably reached out to, you know, some wrong people. I was on a toxic dance floor and I wanted to get off.
To hear more conversations with remarkable Australians, go to aia.com.au/letstalk.